We will now introduce our keynote speaker. Wow, I love it. Of Ngāti Porou, Ngāti Kahungunu, and Irish descent, humble, loving, and caring man of the people, proactively working against violence. He has a self-driven, hands-on approach that spearheads practical initiatives to build community, especially in disadvantaged areas, reversing negative stereotypes, all with a can-do energy and a solid belief in the goodness of people. Please put your hands together and welcome QSM JP, our keynote speaker, Mr. Henare O'Keefe.
You know, when a baby is born, it's pure. It's totally dependent on you, and it wants to be loved and embraced. And Flaxmere, at its birth, was the same. It was warm and inviting and pure and undefiled. There were some injustices that occurred which shouldn't have occurred. There were times when it was neglected and overlooked, abused. So like any child who's been put through that, what do? You go in there, you defend them, and you try to resuscitate them and help bring them back to normality.
Oh, it's a race!
I would give my life for this place. I would literally give my life for these people. They're good people. This beloved suburb of ours, and give her the nurturing and the love that she deserves.
Forgive me if I, if the tears begin to cascade down my cheeks as I stand before you matriarchs and patriarchs that are mandated and morally and ethically bound to serve those less fortunate than ourselves. Loreira, kia ora tātou katoa, ngā mihi whakatau. Me ngā hōkai mahi, me ngā kai whakahaere. O tēnei kaupapa, o te tangata, o te motu. Me ngā māma, me ngā pāpā, me ngā pēpi katoa. Let heaven and earth record that on this day, let God record that on this day, Henare O'Keefe stood in this podium before you all and stood to attention and celebrated and saluted you. Ho mai te pakipaki. A kua tai mai nei a Ngāti Tūreiti. Kua tai mai nei te mokopuno o Hikurangi, Waiapu Maunga, Mangahania, Tūpāro, Waimata Tini, Tikapa, Whareponga, a nei te taho o taku māma, te tau taku pāpa ki Waimarama, here taunga, haukunui, here taunga rarau, here taunga haro te kāhu, here taunga o tākotono. brought my own entourage, as you will you will see. Well, I pray tell that the good Lord will touch the tip of my tongue so that the adjectives will flow trippingly from it and it would resonate with your hearts. It may heal and restore and uplift, inspire, evangelically or otherwise. I don't quite know what your expectations are of me. I've been on this earth for 66 seasons. So I will give you the benefit of 66 years of mistakes. And I've made a few. I have made a few. I met this in 1971. I met this spunky Pākehā chick from Central Hawke's Bay, Takapo. Her name was Pamela Ann Smith at the time. Red hair, green eyes, and knee-high brown leather boots, and orange mini skirt, a brown jacket. I remember that day. As if it was yesterday. So we met in 71, married in 72. That's how long we have endorsed the matrimonial constitution. It hasn't been without its trials and tribulations, I must admit. Standing before you now is certainly not a father that's perfect, certainly not a husband that has been without spot or wrinkle. But I have to say, with all due respect to the matriarchs in the room, she would have to be the most selfless, humble, caring person on the face of the earth. She hates the limelight. She embraces anonymity, just finds it quite abhorrent, whereas I'm totally the opposite. I marinate in the limelight. Or in the case of our beloved village, I marinate in it. We have three biological children of our own who have all flown the coop. And they've turned out to be good people. They are. They're hardworking. They have good values, good morals, certainly not perfect. We have one adopted child, which we were blessed with. She was a little Pākehā girl then, blue eyes, blonde hair, snowy white skin. She's now a mother. And we also have 200 foster children. I knew you would go like that. Yeah. Well, it has been the most rewarding, terrorizing, uplifting, agonizing time of my adult life. But I wouldn't have it any other way. They have taught us so much. Pam and I have been chewed up and spat out with monotonous regularity. We have. So I guess that, plus my 23 years as a freezing worker, plus my years of being the Youth Justice Coordinator for Hawke's Bay, my years as a Hastings District Councillor, now the Ambassador for Hastings, my years as traversing the courts and the prisons of this land as a kaiwhakamana, I guess what I want to do is throw that all together. My years of marriage to Pamela, and I guess I would somehow throw this all together and let's see what unfolds. You probably already perceived that I'm not into writing speeches. I never know what I'm going to say until I stand up. And I kind of like it that way. Born in a two-bedroom tin shack in Ruatoria, on the foot of the mighty Hikurangi Mountain, at the foot, on the perimeter of the equally mighty Waiapu River. Two bedroom tin shack with dirt floors, boxes for cupboards, sugar bags on the windows, where candlelit dinners were the norm. Six brothers, five sisters. We were as poor as you could possibly get in this country, where mum would bake, everything was done on the open fire. The prau rewana or prau krau, Māori bread. She would cook it on the open fire and we kids would wait there eagerly anticipating this delicious, delicious rewana. She would remove it ever so gently from the fire and then proceed to smear it generously with pork fat and golden syrup so that it would slide effortlessly down the larynx. And it was absolutely delicious. Therein, I experienced the aroma of love. Then she would promptly follow it up with a tablespoon of cod liver oil. Do they still do that these days? And proceed to convince us that that was good for us. That was the matriarch. She called a spade, a real Ngāti pro tūturu, straight up the guts, wahine. Her yes was yes and her no was no. There were no in-betweens. There was no compromising, non-negotiable. Then we had a father, had a daddy really, plenty of fathers. We had a daddy. Anybody can be a father, but where are the daddies? He was a man of the land. Shore sheep, carted hay, chopped wood, fenced, milked cows, did all of those to keep the food on the table. He was a warrior on the rugby field and a champion in the home, without doubt. So I've spent my entire adult life attempting to mimic and to duplicate this great man. Not always with a great deal of success, I might add. But unbeknown to my dad, he had a PhD in relationships. It was there in that two-bedroom tin shack down Waimatatini Road, with its dirt floors and boxes for cupboards and sugar bags on the windows to keep out the cold winter chill, that I learnt that relationships were the currency of the future. Nurture them, nourish them, honor them, forgive them, empathize with them, sympathize with them. Never let the sun go down on your anger. Put it right before the sun goes down. Treasure the relationship. Let's talk about children, shall we? You want to talk about the kids? Let's impart to you what I've learned about children. And there are many things. Pray tell, I don't have a monopoly on the art of childrenhood. I don't. I don't pretend to. But 200 foster children, juvenile crime, in and out of the youth courts, every known anomaly and shortcoming known to mankind was committed by these children. So you throw that into the curriculum. I've been to something like 300 schools throughout this country. So you throw that into the curriculum. Children of our own, adopted. So I've learned a thing or two about children. One thing I've learned, well, there are many things I've learned, is this. Children are laughing scud missiles. Waxing evangelically, why would the good Lord say, if I may just, is okay, you're not all agnostic here, are you? If I may somewhat wax evangelical, laughter is the music of the soul. Children are laughing scud missiles. They gravitate towards it with monotonous regularity. Laughter, boom, they're there. Boom, boom. I'll tell you why. It's how they were created. It's how they were designed. It's how we were designed. Laughter is a mother. It's a father. It's a psychiatrist. It's a psychologist. Laughter gives them a sense of value and affirmation. So where appropriate, where possible, bring the humour back. Bring the laughter back. Smiling is infectious. You catch it like the flu. When someone smiled at me today, I started smiling too. I passed around the corner, then someone saw my grin. When he smiled, I realised I'd pass it on to him. Then I thought about that smile, and I realised it's worth. A single smile, just like yours, could travel the whole earth. So if you feel a smile begin, don't leave it undetected. Let's start an epidemic quickly and get the world infected. Tēnā koe, te rangatira, must forgive me. I want to acknowledge our master of ceremonies. Tēnā koe, uso. Thank you so much for introducing me and making me feel real humble. When you introduced me, I said, gee, I can't wait to meet that chap. He sounds okay. So tēnā koe, mate atu koe manaaki e te pāpā. Kia ora. So children, sense of humour. It is vitally important. Bring the humour back into the work. Get it back in there. Therein lies the healing. Therein lies the restoration. Therein lies a value and importance. That is not an exaggeration. It is not an overstatement. It is not an exaggeration or an overstatement. Children are laughing scud missiles. That's the way God wired them. I'll just share this with you before I... Can I meander this way a little bit? Then we'll meander back this way. I feel important to share this with you. I got baptised not too long ago. I've tried everything. I've been there, up, down, everywhere. I've tried everything. I have. I've tried every known rongoā known to mankind and womankind. And I've come to the conclusion, regardless of your faith, whatever that is, it's time to turn back. It is time to bend the knee and look up. I say this in all sincerity. In my 65 years, if I've learned one thing, it's that. It's that. So I had this overwhelming urge to get baptized. I could not describe it. I couldn't figure it out. It was just such a deep, convicting, agonizing at times. So anyway, I said to a friend of mine who happens to be a pastor, I don't go to his church, brother, can an old fella get baptized? He said, anybody can get baptized. I said, great. Will you baptize me? He goes, really? I thought you were already baptized. I said, no, I'm a bit of back to front. Do things back to front. So he said, where would you like to get baptized? Took Ocean Beach. I said, no, my daughter and I got a humble little house. There's a little bit of a hole in the ground. I'd like to get baptized here, right in the middle of Flaxmere, where it all started. And so it was amazing. It goes, so this still small voice said to me, Henare O'Keefe, really, Henare O'Keefe, I am taking your 65 years. I am taking from the book of Genesis back to the book of Revelation. I am taking the pillar of fire by night and the pillar of smoke by day. I am taking the walls of Jericho. I am taking Moses, Matthew, Mark, Luke, John, Acts, Romans, Genesis, Exodus, Leviticus, Numbers, Deuteronomy, Joshua, Judges, Ruth. I am taking Noah. I am taking Moses. I am taking the Red Sea, Henare O'Keefe, and your 65 years. I'm going to bring it all together, and I'm going to meet you in the water. That's true. I've waited 65 years for you. Don't you be late. So I turned up there. I walk around the corner. Where did all these people come from? the mayor, there were politicians of every race, creed, colour and status in life. What an honour. What an honour. All my grandchildren jumped in the water with me. Some dived, but that's okay. And I was baptised. And I rose from that water. And I think, right. I now have this name across here, Henare O'Keefe. That's your mandate. Your evangelical mandate is to spread the love. You can give without loving, but you can't love without giving. You cannot put that in a KPI, an output. You cannot legislate that. No government. What's sitting in this room now with the constitution that are, you can't legislate that. You can't teach that. Be a mother first and a social worker second. Trust the way that God designed you. Trust the architect. Trust him. The patriarch. Be a father first and a social worker second. I promise you, it will not fail you. How could it? Just ask the owner. Ask the designer. Ask the architect. How it will not fail you. I promise you that. Now that I got that off my chest. Teenagers. Teenagers, legends in their own minds, aren't they? Aren't they? Aren't they frustrating? Oh my goodness gracious me. How often has your mum or dad said to you, when you become frustrated, full of anguish with your own children, your mum or dad would say, remind you of anybody? You know that being a teen can be the coolest scene. You get to hang out a lot. You get to strut what you've got. The parties and nightlife do give you a buzz. You party so hard you forget who you was. You re-energize the following day to party some more to make you happy. I love this life of being a teen, of having studs in my nose and hair full of gel cream. Although at times, my mum and dad, their words of caution do make me mad. Weren't they once a teen like me? Or have they forgotten their history? The ups and downs of teenagehood, but look at us now. We came out good. Oh, trust me, mum. Oh, trust me, dad. They'll never forget the love they've had. All due to you, their best of friends. They may stray, but they'll be back again. They must answer the call. They must stand when they fall. They have to step forward, be staunch to the core. Then you will see the best in me. No fear, no pain, you will trust me again. So you see, mum and dad, the lessons you've taught will carry them through. Now give that some thought. Sense of humour, absolutely vital for you and for them. Absolutely vital. It's a must. Do they teach that at social work school? It is an absolute must. You must. It's vital you have the ability, the capacity to laugh at yourselves. It will not demean your mana. It will increase it. It will increase your mana. Silly question, who's been on a marae? What's the first thing that happens when you get to the waharoa and you're waiting? What happens? Absolutely, karanga. Then you start walking slowly, deliberately, reverently towards the dulcet tones of that karanga. True story, a few of my Palangi friends, true story, said, Henare. It's sorry. We would like to go on the marae. We'd like to go on your marae. Can you take us on your marae? We want to learn about you and your culture. I said, oh, well, I'd be honoured. Really? Really? Oh. So, you know, you can talk to them and prepare them as much as you can, but nothing prepares you for the real thing, does it? Not really. So we're standing there, and my mum's standing at the front of the Te Moka Tangata, our whare kai, our whare nui, and then so we start walking towards them, and my friend, who shall remain nameless, because I think some of you know this person, he goes, Henare. Yep, walking. What is she saying? Well, fair question, don't you think? Oh, here comes Henare and all his rich Pākehā mates. Isn't that true? Oh, I hope they got a big koha to give us. We take F-Poss. Ooh, check out that dude with the leather jacket on. Sense of humour, absolutely vital. Look what it's doing for you now. We've got to have fun. We've taken the fun out of it. Or it's been beaten out of us, one way or the other. So sense of humour, absolutely important. I mean, take the culture of youth. I mean, their music, their song, rap, hip-hop, you know, all that. You like it or what? Oh. Like back at, oh, thank you, Cutter. Now there's a warrior for you. Born and bred. Tuturu pahara keke. Lovely to see you, Cutter. I mean, take their music, for example. I mean, in my day we had, what did we have? We have, when the clock strikes, half past 10, dear. We had all those, and then we had Nat King Cole, Ramblin' Rose, all those songs, remember that? Then we had Tina Turner, remember Tina? I'm your private dancer, dancing for money, do what you want me to do. That's what we had. Or Tom Jones. While she's all you ever walked, she's a kind you like the top and take to dinner. You remember them? We had all of them. But in my kids, what did they have? Tell me what you want, what you want, what you really want. Tell me what you want, what you want. Tell me what you want, what you want, what you really want. Tell me what you want, what you want. Tell me, I just want you to shut up. That's what turned them on. If you want to be my lover, you got to get with my friend. I haven't quite figured that one out. So, you see how the culture has evolved. See how it's evolved. So in my experience anyway, the culture has gone from this. From that to this. Who let the dogs out? Who let the dogs out? Who? You still want to be a social worker? This whole curriculum of culture which is coming at us 100 miles an hour with a tailwind going downhill. Despite that, the basics remain the same. Despite that, the basics remain the same. Consistent boundaries. Your yes be yes and your no be no. They'll vehemently disagree with that, but guess what? Guess what? They appreciate it and value it. Don't be persuaded otherwise. Because they see it. Oh, gee, somebody finally cares. Cares enough to say to me, no, no, you can't go. No, no, 5 o'clock, you're home. No longer are they running the home. So all of that. And we all know drugs, alcohol, all that. I've always said to kids, you know what? If God wanted you to smoke, he would have put a chimney in the top of your head. Makes sense, doesn't it? I'll make man in my image. Oh, he's going to smoke. I'll put a chimney up there. You know? Are you sucking on a joint? Go ahead. Go ahead. Are you popping any pills? Go ahead. Go ahead. What happens when you're up and that stuff is in your head? You feel like you're alive when really you're brain dead. I'm telling you, bulletproof and 10 feet tall, that sooner or later, you're going to take a fall. And what will happen then? What are you going to do? The stuff's all gone. You're down to earth. Reality has struck. The problems that you try to hide have hit you like a truck. Oh, where's your family? Where have your good friends gone? I guess they got sick of your never-ending song. Now here you are, all alone, no friend, no foe, no home. You made your choice. It's easy. When life gets tough, get stoned. Now, if you want to know, drugs ain't the way to go. Take life head on. Don't run, don't hide, don't duck behind a joint. Throw that needle far away, because that's really not the point. Family is where it's at, and a friend or two does help. So come on, my friends, open up and let your feelings out. Don't be a fool, don't be a dud, and let drugs take you out. There's more to life, I promise you, than what's going up your snout. So there's all of that. Throw that into your kitty. There's a curriculum, a repertoire of the stuff. Again, if you can find something of value out of that, bless your good heart. Bless your good soul. Just briefly talk about Flaxmere, then I want to meander over to one of our foster children. I live in I always say I married Pam in 71, then shortly thereafter I married Flaxmere. They love me, they despise me, all of those, but I wouldn't have it any other way. Figuratively speaking, not real, they stab you from the front. They do, they don't care where it is, in the supermarket, in the village, no matter where it is, straight up. And I wouldn't have it any other way. And I do. They've captured my heart. They really have. And wherever I go, I wax lyrical about them. I tell the world about this glorious place that I live. They've captured my heart. It's actually more difficult to get out of their heart than it is to get in. But once you're in there, it's a glorious place to be. Warts and all, it's a glorious, glorious place to be. 10,000 of us out there, a very young metropolis. So in 2008, it was a home, leaving out a lot of detail, home invasion. You saw the march there of my daughter's home. Three bandana, hoodie-attired young men went in there. Her then partner answered the door. She was breastfeeding our granddaughter, Aorangi, at the time. Knocked at the door, so She made herself inconspicuous and went into the bedroom to continue to feed Aorangi. He was eight weeks old then. Her partner went, opened the door, and just got smashed and bashed and head put through the wall. At the same time, they were screaming out, I don't take any joy in telling you this. I don't do it to exaggerate my status. There is a method behind my madness. And screaming out profanities, you effing see, where's your effing missus? Get your effing, where the effing hell is, all this. So here she is. Here's where I have newfound reverence and respect for our matriarchs. What she then do, I guess most people would have decamped and left. No, not her. Put baby in the corner, covered her up, walked to the entrance of the lounge with this beating, this abhorrent beating was taking place, and she said, here I am. Here I am. They took one look at her and left. We discovered later it was a case of mistaken identity. This whip board, the Kumara, you know, you heard of texting, Twitter and all that? Well, you can't beat the Kumara vine in Flaxmere, I tell you. It just works overtime. Triple fast fiber. Before we knew it, there were people, friends, family had gathered at our home. When I found out, so I stayed home with the mokopuna, Pam and our children went up to the hospital. They returned about 3 hours later. He was in plaster and just barely shuffling along. She was the equivalent, but more in an emotional state. You know, you can see a broken leg, a black eye, but you can't see a broken heart, can you? You know? So we drank copious amounts of coffee, or because my friends from the Latter-day Saints Church are here, Milo, hot chocolate. So, nothing we could say or do. The odd pat, the odd encouraging word. And then somebody said to me, okay, what are you going to do about it? You know, I'm just so honored. This country has given me, and I love it. Call me the international ambassador of love. I just love that. I love it. And one of my friends said, oh, what are you going to do about it, Mr. Ambassador of Love? That's how he said it. So without critiquing it or thinking about it, I just immediately said, we're going to march. Had no idea how to organize a march. We're going to march. We are going to march. So about a month or 8 weeks later, 5,000 of us, as you saw up there, marched from Paharakeke into the CBD Hastings. Every race, creed, color, rich, poor, not so rich, they were all there. And our catch cry was, enough is enough. We're taking our village back. And it was great. The police attempted to convince me to go down the side street so as not to inconvenience the traffic. I said, no, we're going down the main highway. I did. No. Oh, traffic, I said, I don't care. I want to inconvenience the city. We're going to wake them up. We're going down the main highway. We are. And that we did. That we did. March, or the poor haka pōhiri waiting. And all of a sudden, every political genre known to mankind materialized out of thin air. And they said what I'd expected them to say, no more, enough is enough, you know, we don't have to tolerate this, lock them up, gangs, you're out of here. And I'm listening to all this and I'm thinking, okay, Henare, you're obviously going to speak last. What are you going to say that's different? What are you going to say that's going to stay with these people for the rest of their lives? What are you going to say? What are you going to say? So I found myself saying, you're the policeman. You're the social worker. You're the school teacher. You. If you want to make a difference, take a look in the mirror. If you want to make a difference, take a look in the mirror. When we said we're taking our village back, we meant it commercially, emotionally, spiritually, in every way, shape, and form. We created the Flaxmere Heroes calendar, which we put out every year. We celebrate our heroes and heroines. Every home in Flaxmere gets a calendar free. It's not who to put in, it's who to leave out. We have four All Blacks come out of there. Architects, doctors. I've just finished compiling next year's one. It was just, we found it real difficult. Who are we going to put in? Who are we going to leave out? So come November this year, we're going to the Focal Point Cinema in the CBD Hastings, and we're going to honour them, and we're going to celebrate them. We're going to shout their exploits from the rooftop. So we're taking our community back. We created a community garden, which is open 24/7. People can go in there and help themselves. Help themselves. Take what you need, when you need it. It's never locked. But I always say this is a very special community garden. Blood was spilt. There's a sacrificial lamb. Blood was spilt. Bikes in schools. The U-Turn Trust. The Flaxmere Boxing Academy. Warriors in the ring. Champions in the home. We have 300 registered members. Most of them are ladies. Well, I thought they were ladies. So we've used the science of boxing. Because I was moaning to Pam. I said, could I go in and out of the prison? Oh, geez, I'm brassed up with our men. Gee, they're useless, you know, all this. Well, stop moaning about it. Do something about it. So I set up the Flaxmere Boxing Academy, and we use that as a vehicle. It's not everybody's cup of tea, but once you come to grips with the science of it, it's changing lives, literally. Literally. Bringing families together. Literally. And I could go on and on and on. We just, right now, we started building Waingako Village around our marae, around Te Ara, 122 whare, in collaboration with the Tai Whenua, Heretaunga. There they are, the Tai Whenua Heretaunga. I met with your boss last night, and we just revisited it. And no cars. So ergonomically, we're going to force, cajole, encourage people to talk to one another. The cars will be around the perimeter. And we're going to karanga everybody that moves into their home. We're going to karanga them in. Every home. We decided that. Every home, when you move in, somebody will be there to karanga you. You heard about a village to raise a child? Well, ane te rongo o te rangatira a popo. Ane. Right here. This, you just watch this space. We are taking ownership. We are taking responsibility. We ain't waiting for government. We're not waiting for them. Don't hold your breath. They have no answers, no answers. Simply because they think in 3-year increments. What can I endorse to keep me in power? That's a fact, that's the reality. So all of that. So anyone else, there's much more I could rave on about our beloved village. As I said, we've had over 200 foster children, and I could wax lyrical about any one of them. I could wreck. Tell you about Jackie, Pākehā girl. You're useless, you're gutless, you'll never amount to anything. She now owns 3 logging trucks, Mack trucks. Mack, little petite Pākehā girl from Waipukuro. She drives one, her husband drives the other, and they employ someone else. Mack, just huge. You've seen these machines, they're huge. She rocks up. Righto. You'll never amount to anything. I could tell you about James right here in Auckland, lawyer. There's no such thing as a bad baby. They're not born like that. They are not born like that. Peel away that rough, gruff exterior. Peel away the decades of bad habits. Have you got the constitution to do that? Have you got the time to do that? Peel away that rough exterior and go looking for that precious jewel that once resided in that body. They weren't born like that. Something has happened. Get to the heart of it. Get to the cause of it. Trust the mother. Trust the father. Because that's where the magic is. Sometimes I think we get too analytical. I think. I want to talk about one He came to us with his four sisters and his mum. Would make Jack the Musk look like a pussycat. The tinny houses, you know, I don't have to go into detail. You use your worst imagination. His father prematurely took his own life, and that's when their lives, he reckons, turned for the good. So they made this intrusion into our lives, to Pam and I. These four girls and this 10-year-old boy who had a chip the size of Mount Everest on both shoulders. And it took me at least 12 months just to get to base one with them. But I knew it wasn't going to happen overnight. You want to take care of my sisters, my mum? Who are you? I don't know you. Who are you? I'm not going to trust you. You want me to trust you? You earn it. He didn't say that. I read it. I picked up the body language. Took me a year just to get him to hug me. We'd walk down the passage in the home, and I'm walking down the passage, the girls are coming towards me, they just get up against the wall and freeze. And I'm thinking, oh my God, what right do you have to treat our kids like that? Who the hell are you? But you know, with my wonderful, wonderful wife, her patience, and in 2007, he was voted the top Shakespearean actor in Australasia. Gee, I'm a tonguey wet away. Running out of tissues, cutter. Thank you so much. In 2008, he was voted the top Shakespearean actor in Australasia. In 2008. I take back everything I said about you.
Thank you.
In 2008, he was voted the best opera singer in New Zealand. Right here in the Auckland Town Hall. There we are. We went to the finals. Never been to an opera in my life. Went from sausage sizzles to champagne and caviar overnight. We did, literally. But before that, about 6 months before that, he said, "Mum, Dad, can I talk to you?" Sure. He had quite a serious demeanor. So we sat down. He said, I'll never forget it. "I'd like to change my name to O'Keefe." "I know," I said. "Right. O'Keefe would look pretty good in lights." let's get him there before he changes his mind. That's a fact. And enter that matriarchal constitution I often wax lyrical about in the form of my wife, Pam. Thank God common sense prevailed. She goes, "Well, hang on a moment." Thinking, what's going on here? Hang on. She said, "Son, you want to take on our name? What an honor. What an honor." "Oh," she said, "but I want you to consider one thing. I want you to think about this. We're not saying no. Just want you to think about it." She said to him, "I want you to retain your own name. And you put the mana and the integrity back into that name. What about your mother? What about your sisters? Are they going to change their names?" And I'm thinking, gee, why didn't I think of that? Honestly, my ego just ran away with me. Well, thank God. Thank God common sense prevailed. So there we are. We walked the red carpet. Cue from here too. And I'm thinking, wow. These fellas, they don't know who we are. They've come to see our son. It was a bit of spot the Maori there, I tell you. True. Well, there it is. The New Zealand Symphony Orchestra in all of its glory in the Auckland Town Hall. And every one of those opera singers, they've become very good, like family members to us now. They were magnificent. They really were. But, ladies and gentlemen, the winner of the Lexus 2007 is Philip Rhodes. His name just cut through the air. The Prime Minister was there, the Governor General was there, the who's who. Helen Clark was the Prime Minister that day. She gets up, she presents him with a bouquet of flowers and all this, and the confetti coming from, some of you might have been there, come from the ceiling, you know. He's standing there on the air, he's looking down, he's going, he's probably thinking, this shouldn't be happening. You know, I'm supposed to be in jail. I'm supposed to be a woman beater, an alcoholic, a drug addict. I shouldn't be up here. $10,000 cash, a trip or two around the world, and a three-year scholarship under the best voice coach in the world, Dennis O'Neill. They all go to him. I'm thinking, wow. So quickly, we go to the after-match function, right? And I walk in, that's what I call it, after-match. Walk in there, and it's just the opulence. The opulence of Lexus, that Lexus car there, one here, either side of the stage. I walk in there, and Philip had been, of course, inundated by the press and fans. And so, you can take the boy out of Flaxmere, but you can't take Flaxmere out of the boy. So I hopped in one of the cars. It's true. Flash, you know. How much you want for this speak? It was, that's a true story. There's a tap on the front screen window. These two ushers, magnificent looking ladies, said, oh, Mr. O'Keefe. I go, yes. Your son's asking where you are. We'd like to. So I come out and one grabbed this hand, one grabbed that hand, and we walk towards him. He had his back towards me. Just throngs of people. Tapped him on the shoulder. He turned around. And we just cried like two little babies. We wept and we wept. We didn't care. Because we knew where he'd come from. We knew. And the country was yet to find that out. The world was yet to find that out. Was yet to find that out. Anyway, have a look at this short video.
My father joined me on the day of the final in Auckland.
We stood out on the balcony and I just can remember saying to him, geez, look at this, son. This is a long way from Lipscomb Crescent.
You know, he sat there in his ever positive manner and said, oh, I can feel tonight's your night. You know, he said, I can feel it.
It was his time, his season, for all the hurt and the trials and the tribulations and the grief. It was payback time. For me, it was a very new experience. You know, I came from sausage sizzles, hangi and rugby. That was my world. I think I borrowed a suit, had to borrow a tie, borrow a shirt. And I'm thinking, geez, they've come to see my son. They've come to see my son.
I think
all
I
those singers were magnificent.
We've started
each one of them
early.
Would have done the title prayer.
Is that right at the beginning?
But I have to say he had that little bit extra. That dark
it's
side
the,
came through.
The Philip Rhodes actor / singer. Sorry about that, folks.
Say that I'm at a stage now
that's
where
it. That's
I'm
the
good
one.
Enough
thank
to
you,
grace
brother.
The stage with her, which is a huge honour. It's not daunting, but at the same time, you never forget who she is. She has had a career that's spanned decades, and she's been the best at what she does. I'm really looking forward to stepping on stage with her and showing what I've got.
As old as time.
Tis as old as time.
True as it can be.
True as it can be.
And even friends that somebody depends unexpectedly.
I do quite often have moments where I think this can't be happening. To be standing on stage with a world-renowned superstar, sometimes it does wash over me to think, oh, such a lucky man. I do think of my sisters, and I think of where we all were, you know, in that home, growing up. We grew up in Lipscomb Crescent, me, myself, and five younger sisters. Neither of my parents had jobs, and they were partial to the drink, and my dad in particular was partial to quite a few drugs, and the result of that, I guess, is a violent and unsettled upbringing, really. Our mum found it hard to get help for us because all the neighbours were in the same sort of boat. If you dare to say something, the treatment would be twice as bad. After a severe beating by my father and threats that he would come back and do some more, she jumped in a car, not fully knowing how to drive, packed up the children and left. Unfortunately, it was in a severe car crash. My two twin sisters were injured, having both sort of gone through the windscreen. My mum has never forgiven herself for that. Mum couldn't watch us all the time, and I was the oldest. There were lots of opportunities to just take myself off whenever I liked. I used to bike up Tomato Peak and sit up there. Whilst I was up there, I'd always kind of wished that things might get better with my dad and mum, or something else would happen that could just sort of, you know, give us a better life, because it's just outside your front door. You can see there is a better life to live. And I wish that I could be part of that somehow. So it was a place of hope, but without any sort of knowledge of what that could be. My father knew the difference between right and wrong, and I think all of the decisions he had made had weighed heavily in his consciousness. He had always had suicidal tendencies and had threatened my mother to kill himself. Eventually, it was those suicidal tendencies that he gave into after well, a life of bad decisions, really. Our mum was in such a state that she couldn't look after us, having lost the man she loved. And as bad as he was, he provided for her in his own way. So social welfare intervened and ripped us away from our mother, which was, at the time, really hard. Initially, we were split up as well, but it only took a few months before I was put into the family home that my two sisters, Selena and Katrina, were in. Now, the people who looked after us at the time said, "Oh, you've got some new people coming to look after you." And I can remember just waiting all day for them to arrive and hoping that they might be a bit better.
So we walk up there and you see these kids. Philip stood back, and understandably so. You know, here was the man of the house.
He'd had some real bad experiences in his life. I could see on their faces, who are these people? You know, are they going to love me? It was really an emotional time for them, frightening time. Not only that, it was quite scary for us too, because we had a newborn baby as well as our own.
I sort of felt there was something better right away. And that was simply by being greeted by them with a big hug. And
we just put our arms around them and said that we love them and we're here to take care of them.
The first instance was getting a big hug from Pam, and she was already in tears, and we knew those were tears of love, and that that she didn't want to see children ill-treated. And that was the first sign of hope, really.
He's only 10 years old, but he had matured beyond years. He had to. He had to grow up overnight.
When we first were fostered, I did take on the mantle as the man of the house.
Thank you, brother. Thank you for that. No need to say much, really, is it? He's touring the world. He's everywhere. I got a phone call about, just a couple of quick ins. I got a text one day, sitting in council, running a city. And I got this text, my phone lit up, and it was from him. He said, "Dad, I've just walked through the Garden of Gethsemane. I've stood in the sepulchre where Jesus lay, and tonight I'm singing with Placido Domingo." "Son, I'm in Flaxmere." Anyway, I got a phone call from him, because I want to read something for you before I conclude. A phone call from him about 3 days ago. You may or may not know, but he makes his Covent Garden debut. I know. When you get to Covent Garden, you've hit the big time. Pavarotti has sung there, Jose Carreras, Mario Lanza, Kirita Kanawa, they've all been there. I said, "Son, really? You're going to stand where the greats have stood, son. And when you sing, you're going to give others hope." So he phoned and I said, "Oh, well, we come over, the good Lord willing, we'll be there, son." Anyway, it was him. He was in Switzerland. He hopped off the train because the train was too noisy to phone. So he hopped off the stage. He said, "Dad, you and Mum are coming to London. Your prayers have been answered. Gee, I hope God flies first class, son." That's true. He said, "Well, whichever way, Dad, you're coming." So some kind, obviously fiscally endowed person has chosen to fly us over there. We leave here on the 12th of September, come back on the 23rd. He said, "All expenses paid, son." I said, "Wow, son, that's just unbelievable." So anyway, just briefly, Pam's not going. Yeah, it's too long. It's a long, long way to go, and plus fear of flying and all that. I said to her, "It doesn't seem right. We go without you. You're that boy's heart. You are." He said to me one day, "Dad, you're the man. You're great, but Mum's the man." And so I let him know that. I said, "Son, just be aware that Mum may not come." And he went quiet on the phone. And here's what he sent me. This is what he texted me. So the family met and we decided to take the most mischief of our children, Rebecca. Because our family decided that Rebecca needs this. She needs a shot in the arm. And that's how we roll in the O'Keefe house. That's just how we roll. She doesn't deserve to go. But the family have decided, "No, Dad, I think Rebecca should go with you." Dad, it would be wonderful to bring Rebecca. For me, it is important you don't come alone. I have tried ringing Mum, and I will try again. But she could never, ever disappoint me. Her embrace on the very first day that we met was the first ever hug I remember as a child. Dad, Mum has earned her right to come or not to come. Of course, I would love to have her share this experience, but I need her to know that I feel her love in every decision I make. I feel her love in every decision I make, every gesture of kindness, every gesture of humanity. It is her way of love that has often guided me. Her love from that first tear-filled embrace helped me survive. Even now, in this very selfish, single-mindedly, jealously filled vocation in which I have chosen, where people would rather trample over their colleagues for fear others may honour their talent, she taught me to give respect to everyone, even those that don't deserve it. If not for them, but for my own mana. Dad, she could never, ever disappoint me. Can I just say I love you all very much? And I appreciate you and value you. I really do. And on behalf of this country, if you haven't been told you're great, you're wonderful, well, I'm telling you. And yeah, when you stuff up, the whole world knows about it. That's right, eh? You do something wonderful, you end up on page 12 at the bottom. It's just the way it is. I got the degree. I'm a qualified social worker, but I don't intend going back to that. You're wonderful, and thank you so much. Mā te atu koutou manaaki, ngā mihi o te tauhou kia koutou. Nō reire e te pāpā, e te whāia, kia kaha, kia kaha. Kia kaha tō ihi, tō wehi, tō kaha, tō whakapanaungatanga. Koe nei te rongoa tō matu anui te rangi. All that, the love and all that, that's the rongoa from God Almighty. You can't legislate that. Anyway, I want to end on a joyous note. I got this little thingamajig the brother and I arranged. So I'd like you all to please, ladies and gentlemen, please be upstanding. This is my anthem around the country. Full blast, full blast. I hope you like it. Turn that up, brother. Here we go. The love train. Come over here. Love train. Oh yeah. Don't you know that?
nothing better than me to live. Here we go. We're on the love train, who saw? People around the world, join hands on the love train, love train. People around the world, join hands on the love train, love train. People around the world, join hands on the love train, love train. People around the world, join hands on the love train.
Ladies and gentlemen,
thank you, my brother. Bless you.
Ladies and gentlemen, my name is Henare O'Keefe, and I am indeed the International Ambassador of Love.
Another big round of applause. Henare O'Keefe, QSM, JP, Ambassador of Love. And now, Pastor O'Keefe. Thank you. Articulate, captivating, humorous, and if I can coin a WWE phrase, so much intestinal fortitude. There we go. We have been so greatly blessed. All the best to you and your beautiful wife. And in the work that you continue to do in serving your community, even if your caseload far exceeds that of many, many of us, God bless you. And if I can just, being a man of faith, here's the word for you today, brother. Galatians chapter 6, verse 9, and to everyone here, let us not be weary in well-doing, for in due season we shall reap if we faint not.